Good evening, everybody. I'm Zul Morali. I'm the president and CEO of the Royal's Institute of Mental Health Research, which is affiliated with the University of Ottawa. And on behalf of the Royal, I would really like to welcome you all, extend you a warm welcome to this Conversations at the Royal. So we have a regular series of outreach activities to connect with the community and share our research findings. So welcome. I've also been asked by our communications team to let you know that that this lecture is being streamed live on Facebook. So I only warn you because I want you to keep your questions tame when you ask them. We also have people participating remotely through the OTN network. So welcome participants on the OTN. Just please keep your mics at the OTN sites on mute. Thank you. So the Royal-Mach-Gaensslen Prize for Mental Health Research was established in 2015. And to recognize and support early career Canadian researchers in mental health. And this annual prize, funded by a very generous donation by the Mach-Gaensslen Foundation, provides recognition and funding for outstanding rising stars in research in mental health. This is a very important activity because we do support, as you know, rising stars in area of literature, Canadian literature. We have the Giller Prize, for example. We recognize our hockey players, star hockey players. And the people who conduct research in the area of mental health are really unsung heroes. They're working day and night to try and find solutions for mental illness. And so they too deserve recognition, like what we recognize other people. So our keynote speaker tonight is Dr. Rudolf Uher. He was the 2016 winner of this much coveted prize, and he has been, since he got his prize in the fall, he's been making tours across Canada to disseminate information about the kind of work in mental health research that he carries out. And he arrived in Ottawa only last night, evening, and to make sure that he was stressed enough, the airport managed to lose his bags. And then to top it off, he had to run off and buy a jacket and new clothes to be able to join us for dinner that night. And then we want to make sure that he still had a bit more stress. And so this morning, he was on CBC radio live and was interviewed there.
What time is it?
7:30, so he was there at 7. So welcome, Dr. Uher, to the capital of the stress capital of Canada. Now, he has spent most of the day today meeting with our researchers and young investigators, students. And so thank you very much for dedicating so much time, your precious time with us. Dr. Uher is a holder of a prestigious Canada Research Chair in the University of Dalhousie Department of Psychiatry. And he has published many seminal articles in the area of mental health research. And he has several research grants, including a recent rare foundation grant from CIHR, the Canadian Institute of Health Research. So his early research confirmed findings that children of parents with existing mental illness are much more likely to develop mental illnesses themselves as they mature. And because of this genetic or biological sensitivity, Dr. Uher believes that if children are given the tools to cope with mental illnesses or symptoms of mental illness early enough in life, they would have a greater chance to reduce the incidence and severity of mental illness as they grow up. So an interesting question is, can the solution to treating long-term mental illness be found in childhood? In other words, can one change the trajectory of mental illness by intervening very early on in life of vulnerable individuals? And that's the premise of a new study that's being conducted at Dalhousie University by Dr. Rudolf Uher's team. His study is the first to examine the genetic sensitivities in childhood and the link to mental illness. And he seeks to offer offer solutions by giving individuals tools to detect and to intervene for these mental illnesses very early on, to see whether this would help mitigate their trajectory towards developing mental illness, either in terms of severity or in terms of the incidence. So Dr. Uher will be discussing the early results from his study, which is called Families Overcoming Risks and Building Opportunities for Well-Being, or 4BOW is the acronym that's being used. And so he'll tell us about the study itself and share the preliminary results from these findings. So welcome, Dr. Uher, for coming to Ottawa to share your exciting research findings. And thank you to McGainsland Foundation for supporting tonight's lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, so. Bonsoir et bienvenue au Royal. Je suis ravi que vous êtes tous venus pour parler de santé mentale. Je vais donner la conférence en anglais, mais n'hésitez pas à poser des questions en français si vous désirez. So, good evening. I'm glad that so many people have come on the budget day night. Still, there's some people interested in mental health, and I'm really, really pleased that this is a public lecture. Who is not mental health professional here? That's great. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for coming. And I'm a psychiatrist and a researcher, and I will talk about preventing mental illness, or about the possibility to prevent mental illness, which is really what we're trying to do in Halifax. Before that, I have to say big thank you to the Mach-Gaensslen Foundation and the Royal. The foundation has decided to dedicate a substantial portion of its wealth to advancing research, not just medical research, but specifically research in mental health. Research in psychiatry is one of the three areas they fund. And together with the Royal, they decided to make these funds available across Canada, to make this a national prize, which is a very generous decision. I was here in October for the prize presentation, a very pleasant occasion, and I'm glad that it didn't end with that. I'm glad that the foundation has also decided to support this tour to really raise the public awareness of mental illness in general and about specifically the research we're doing. Thank you. I will be talking about what I call severe mental illness. So these are diseases like schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and the more severe and recurrent cases of major depression. This is what we as adult psychiatrists spent most of our career with. These are the types of illness that affect people for life or for significant parts of their life, that often prevent people from achieving their full potential, or that require very intensive treatment in order to allow people to do well in life. So they are illnesses that affect individuals, their families, and the society a lot. In terms of what they cost, they are expensive for sure, not just because of the treatment required, but because they take people away from the productive workforce. They don't allow people to always be complete education and be at work. So depression, bipolar disorder, and schizophrenia cost Canada more than all types of cancer combined. Specifically about $50 billion every year, just that we are on budget night. In addition, when you think of the major challenges of health across the lifespan, then mental illness tends to be the first one to manifest. It's often the chronic disease of the young. Anxiety typically starts in childhood. I mean, we all had anxieties in childhood, but some had much more of that than others. And in the teens, that's usually when the first mood problems start, and those who will have them psychosis soon after that. When we're thinking of the biggest problem, health problems in the middle age, then probably diabetes and related cardiovascular morbidity. And when we're thinking of old age, then dementia is the big scare, really. And well, I'll tell you, all these are related. Anxiety is the strongest predictor of mood problems that we know. Most types of psychosis start as mood problems. Mood and psychosis predict both diabetes and dementia. And all these are strong relationships. Each of these previous disorder doubles or more the risk of the next one. So these are this is not something to overlook. And mental health problems are the first one that manifest. And they are really the first opportunity for us to interrupt early what I call the life course continuity of ill health. So if we have a chance to improve our health across the lifetime, let's do it early. Can we prevent or cure mental illness? I mean, we've been trying to cure it for many, many decades, and by and large, we fail, unfortunately. I mean, not that we do not have effective treatments. We do have treatments that do make a huge difference for some, but typically they are not a cure. We are able to diminish the symptoms, to diminish their impact, and we're not able to stop the illness that, in a way that it wouldn't be there anymore. And I cite here J.J. Heckman. He's a Nobel Prize in economics, and he did a lot of calculations that suggest that the earlier we invest into human potential in terms of either health or education, the better return we get, the more chance we have to really improve a lot. And I think that's true for mental health as well, not just for schooling. So I'll be talking about prevention, about what we tried much less of than treatment. And when we talk about prevention, it's about stopping illness from developing before it starts. And we can talk about universal prevention, something that we could do for everyone in school. And honestly, I do think mental health education should be there in schools. But the programs that advanced universal prevention, there's been Sure Start in the US, Head Start in the UK, they have been generally beneficial. They've been very beneficial for the average families. But they also found that the families who are at highest risk to start with, the more deprived and less resourceful families, were actually not able to benefit from these generic programs. In general, those who already have quite a bit managed to take advantage of other resources as well. So I believe for severe mental illness, and for the kids and young people who are at the highest risk, we need indicated prevention. And that has two stages. We first need to identify risk early. We need to find who needs it. And then we deliver the intervention that we believe makes difference. And that's what I'll be talking about today. So first, early identification of risk. It is really about being able to select those who may have higher chances than others, higher risk than others to develop severe mental illness before any deterioration starts, before when they still have a chance for full fulfilling life. And that actually may mean in childhood, because mental illness starts early in life. The highest risk of onset is between age 15 and 25. So I think we have to go earlier than age 15 if we want to make a really big difference. How we do it? By pulling together everything we know about mental illness. We specifically do it as by combination of genetic risk, which mostly means family history. So in FORBO, we take in many youth from many different sources, but we especially invite sons and daughters of parents who have either schizophrenia or bipolar disorder or depression. It was also part of my initial motivation to work with this group, because I had many patients who are parents and who worried about their kids. The other part of our risk identification is what I call antecedents. So these are early small problems that precede, at least by number of years, and predict higher risk of severe mental illness later on. What are they? I will talk about it for a bit more. But first, let me tell you about the genetic risk, so family history. We have pulled together all the studies that looked at children of parents with mental illness. And by crunching all the numbers together, the result is that about 1 in 3 sons and daughters of who has one or both parents with depression, bipolar disorder, or schizophrenia will develop one of these conditions by their early 20s. 1 in 3 is too high risk to just watch it happening again. Specifically, it's 32%. So I believe these sons and daughters of people with severe mental illness, I mean, they are more likely to remain healthy than to become ill, but the risk of becoming ill is too high to leave it alone, really. They need help. In the last decade, we have been able to do a lot of measurement of the actual genetic variants that may be behind the risk. Don't try to understand the details of this slide. But what I'll try to show is by grouping together the three symbols in the pink circle, it really shows us that genetically there's more in common than separate about schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and major depressive disorder. We used to believe there will be a gene for schizophrenia, there will be a gene for bipolar disorder. Well, there isn't, we know now. But there's many genes that increase the risk a little bit. And they tend to increase the risk for schizophrenia and bipolar disorder and depression. The same genes, more commonly than different ones. None of them causes the illness. They more like sensitivity. So although there's a huge genetic contribution to the risk of mental illness, it's not deterministic. It's not something we can't do anything about. Many of these genes will be more like making someone sensitive. So what will eventually develop depends a lot on what happens and what that person does. And that's why I believe we can work with genetic risk and we can change it, especially if we start early on. I'll now turn to the antecedents, to the early small problems that we know we can solve more easily, and yet if they are not solved, they predict more severe problems later on. We really scoured the literature to find what the best antecedents may be, what may be measurable in childhood or early adolescence and predict later problems in adulthood. And the first one I call affective lability. I always give a description in the word of our words of our participants in blue on the top. So here's a description of a son by his mother. She says, he often gets grumpy and unhappy quickly for no apparent reason. We never know what he will be like the next hour. So this is a description of someone whose mood is labile. Often out of proportion, there are sudden changes in mood out of proportion to what is happening. So this is what we call affective lability. Probably a very common finding. If you have toddlers at home, you will probably think, oh, of course. But most toddlers grow out of it. You know, some people don't quite. So we talk about it. Sometimes we give it names like oppositional defiant disorder or more recently disruptive mood dysregulation disorder. We talk of irritability, being cranky, and all these really are related, and they do predict depression, they do predict bipolar disorder, they probably do predict psychosis. So that's why we call it an antecedent. We also feel it's, you know, not so severe in itself, and we know how to deal with it. So we measure it with questionnaires. The second one is anxiety. So very common experience. Most kids feel anxious at that time. And serious anxiety makes people and children avoid activities, avoid encounters, avoid novel situations. And that's the level where it becomes problematic. Here I have a quote from one of our parent participants, actually. He says, in my teenage years, I was paralyzed with anxiety. If I got help with it then, perhaps I would not have bipolar disorder now. Well, I don't know, but I thought this is a hypothesis worth testing. Anxiety is really common in childhood. It typically starts in childhood. So it very strongly predicts cases of depression. Depression that's not preceded by anxiety is exception. I haven't seen many cases of depression that have not been preceded by anxiety. For bipolar disorder, it's also the case. And it gives us certainly plenty of time to intervene, and we know what to do with anxiety. Anxiety is very treatable without pills, by psychological means, so let's use it. The third antecedent are psychotic symptoms. So this may sound more scary. They are very unusual experiences, hearing things other people don't hear, seeing things other people don't see, believing or not feeling safe in a situation that other people would think is safe. This is an example from, I believe, an about 11-year-old girl participating in Forbo. I kept hearing an evil laugh. I also heard a loud voice at my grandmother's house saying, "Go home." I asked my grandmother, "Did you hear that?" And she said, "Hear what?" So this is a good description of typical psychotic experience in a child. Right, this is not psychosis. I mean, this girl is not schizophrenic. She functions well. This is just a one-off experience or infrequent experience. I mean, it happens repeatedly, but not constantly. And she found it disturbing. Obviously, at the time, she believed it's real. It's a real voice because she asked her grandma, you know, "Did you hear that?" And was surprised she did not. And experiences like this are actually relatively common in childhood. Probably around 15% of children between age 8 and 12 have experiences like this, so not uncommon at all. They mostly don't share them, or they quickly learn not to share them, because the first time they do, they get a weird look, right? And that may be what's dangerous about them, because you learn to separate your private experiences from your interactions with others, and that may just not be good for further development. And that may be why they actually do predict psychotic illness, severe mental illness, later on in adulthood. You know, not deterministic. Many children with unusual experiences do not develop severe mental illness, but those who have unusual experiences are more likely to. And we can work with them. They also need to be worked with, because the children find them distressing, especially when they're not sharing them. The last one I call basic symptoms. These are also kind of unusual experiences, often loss of function. The differences with basic symptoms, the individual immediately knows that something's wrong with them, that they are kind of subjectively irritating and alarming. This is an example of loss of function, basic symptoms. Suddenly, I could not understand what words meant, words that I knew before. This happened several times in the past, few months, not before. So a kind of distinct experience, perhaps more unusual. They are actually less common than psychotic symptoms, but not that uncommon. We do get fair amount of positives when we ask children about them. You need to ask specifically. And they do predict severe mental illness with quite a delay, about 6 years later. So there's plenty of time to do something if this very early sign is happening. So these are my four antecedents. I'll tell you something about the group. So we call the study and the cohort Families Overcoming Risks and Building Opportunities for Well-Being. The cohort is entirely in Nova Scotia. That's where we carry out this research. And at present, we have 346 youth in the cohort, at least of the end of last week. Now it may be 350. On average, they are 10-year-old when they enter the cohort, about 50-50 boys and girls. And once we enroll them, we see them once every year. We started just over 4 years ago, so we just started to see the first batch of participants for the fifth time. So they do come back fairly regularly. The parents, we also see them. They also are participants in our study. So in addition to the 346 youth, we also have 377 parents who also are participating in the study. So this is a family affair. We are about halfway enrolling. We need at least 600 youth in the cohort to complete what we want to do. When I separate them by whether a parent has mental illness, we have about 85 youth where none of the two parents has severe mental illness. They can still have anxiety or addiction, but not one of the mood or psychotic disorders. About 135 of the youth have had one or both parents with major depression. Almost 100 have a parent with bipolar disorder, and about 30 have a parent with schizophrenia. I first looked how whether the antecedents are actually linked to family history. Are they more common in kids who have a parent or both parents with a severe mental illness? I just showed the sump number. Yes, they are. I mean, the controls on average have less than one antecedent, so most of the children of parents without mental illness do not have an antecedent, whereas the average in the children of parents with any one depression, bipolar disorder, or schizophrenia is higher than one. So the majority of children with affected parents will have one or more of the antecedents. On average, it's about half and half. Half of the kids have one or more antecedent, half of them do not. Now, the bigger question is, do the antecedents actually predict who will develop severe mental illness? And now, just over four years into the study, I must say, initially, I was not expecting we would be able to say anything about it by now, but we are actually, which is kind of bad news, because it means quite a large number of the kids in the cohort are already falling ill. It tends to be the older ones, the older half of the cohort. We have completed 474 follow-ups of children that we consider to be at risk for onset, which means they did not have any of these mood or psychosis diagnoses when we saw them for the first time. And they are in their teens during the follow-up, 9 years or older. And we've been fortunate because almost all of our participants are coming back to see us again every year. So we have 95% retention, which is really a crucial feature of the study. That's what's needed to make it valid. And during these 474 follow-up years, there were 25 new onsets. So 25 adolescents who did not have a major mood or psychotic disorder when we first saw them have developed one. This is quite a lot. It's more than I expected, I must say. Most often this is depression, 20 cases, but we also had 2 cases of bipolar disorder, 2 cases of schizophrenia, and 1 case of schizoaffective disorder, so that's something in between bipolar and schizophrenia. That makes for an incident of over 50 per 1,000 person years, which is quite a lot. It really just reflects again how high is the risk in families with where someone already has severe mental illness. On average, there are 17-year-olds when the onset happens. Now, when I separate them into the two halves, those who did and those who did not have one or more antecedent on the previous assessments, then 24 out of the 25 onsets happened in those who did have an antecedent before. Only one single onset we could not predict. One onset of depression occurred in a youth who did not have any one of the antecedents. I looked at that case actually why, and I could see we were discussing the diagnosis of social anxiety disorder. We ended up not giving the diagnosis because perhaps there was not enough impairment. So it wasn't like there was nothing, but it didn't meet the threshold. So that means the risk in those with an antecedent is 22-fold. It's 22 times higher than in those without. In other words, yes, what we picked from the literature as being published as potentially preceding mental illness, it definitely works as an early identification strategy. We can predict, we can reduce our sample to approximately one half of those where most of the onset or almost all of the onsets will happen. Well, more than that, because there's many youth who have actually more than one of the four antecedents. And the risk of developing mental illness rises steeply like this with the number of antecedents. So from very close to zero in those without to around 5%, 10%, 15%, it doubles with every additional antecedent. So in those who had all four of them at previous assessment, which is a small subgroup, the risk of developing major mood or psychotic disorder is actually around 35%. I initially thought that we, you know, our initial strategy was we choose youth with any one of the four antecedents and we offer them a intervention. So just cut a line and, you know, those who fall in, we do something for you so that we reduce risk. Having seen this, I really think we may eventually need to go to something more nuanced, because those who have who score both high on family history and have multiple antecedents, they are at such a high risk that they almost require treatment. I also look back at the family history. So this is the relationship between number of affected parents. So we only had, I think, one onset in someone who did not have affected parent, much higher risk in those who did have affected parent, and actually looks like even higher risk in those where both parents are affected. We have small group of those families. So all the predictors seem to work. We could improve the prediction further. This is prediction from a thinking puzzle or memory puzzle, where youth are asked to remember a story in a logical way, and performing poorly on that relatively simple test seems to predict risk as well, and independently of the antecedent. So difference from about 2% to 8% of risk of onset. Environment matters, of course. We ask about bad experiences in childhood, about childhood maltreatment, bullying. In children who were exposed to maltreatment, either abuse or neglect, the risk is elevated multiple fold, again from compared to about 2% to 10%. So we see a strong prediction from antecedents, from family history, and there's potential addition from cognition and environment. So my interim conclusion is mental illness is predictable, much more predictable than what the textbook said when I was studied psychiatry in school. Well, if we can predict it, we may be able to prevent it. So what we actually do, what we do, we call it preemptive early intervention. That's just to distinguish them from the early intervention that my colleagues have been trying to do in the very early stages of actual mental illness. So we try to go earlier than that. What we do, we be able to test them because Forbo follows a special design. It's a group of people that we follow over time. Again, apologies for a complex slide. But you see there's a big box and there's smaller boxes within them. And that shows that we can follow a large group of kids over time. And in that, we can nest something that we call clinical trial. That's the comparison of intervention. And it helps us really to assess the long-term effects of the intervention in a way that's pretty reflective of what would typically happen in the real world. My criteria for choosing intervention, it has to be acceptable to the youth and their families. It absolutely has to be safe. I mean, children at early stages with potential risk, you know, I don't want to give them anything that causes side effects or that's burdensome. And hopefully it will be effective. It will actually meaningfully reduce the risk of mental illness. So what would such intervention be? I'm sure many of you have ideas. We thinking both psychological and pharmacological intervention, youth-focused, parent-focused. You know, something that you can take as a pill that yet it doesn't have side effects would be very attractive, right? It would be easy to give it to many. And indeed, there was an indication in the literature that polyunsaturated fatty acids, in other words, fish oils or omega-3 oils, may be helpful. It's kind of brain food, right? It may be helpful. People tried it with young people at high risk, at very high risk for schizophrenia in kind of later phase of risk than what we do. And initially it looked helpful. Well, there was a large trial completed of 300 such individuals. And essentially it found zero benefit. So unfortunately, fish oils are out as of this year. So I'm glad that's not what we bet on. One of the conclusions for that study is everyone in that study got a psychological intervention as well. So they either got fish oils or placebo, but everyone got a helpful psychologist working with them in what's called CBCM, Cognitive Behavioral Case Management. And one of the conclusions that the authors of the study have made, well, perhaps that psychological part was helpful enough so that there was not too much wiggle room left for the officials to actually make a difference in addition to it. We call it ceiling effects in more learned language. And, well, therefore we do not choose polyunsaturated fatty acids. I also looked at the effects of pure psychological treatment, cognitive behavioral therapy, that has also been tested in young people at ultra high risk for psychosis. And this one seemed to work, at least in the short to medium term. Within about 12 months, it reduced the risk of full psychosis developing to about half. People didn't really get better that much, but they didn't develop more severe type of illness. So, purely psychological treatment seems to work. It's also definitely acceptable. It seems to be what the people and families want, you know, someone to work with you and teach you how to deal with life. And therefore we developed an adaptation of cognitive behavioral therapy to young people without a manifest full illness, to those who are not treatment seeking. So essentially, we take the recipe that seems to work for full disorders and we make it into coaching. So we don't do therapy because these kids are not seeking treatment at that time, right? So they will not get therapy. They will get coaching. We offer them a course of coaching where they learn life skills, emotional skills, skills for mental health. It's one-to-one. It's person-tailored. It's personalized. We have core modules that we do with everyone, and we have optional modules that we choose according of which antecedent they come with. So we do something else with an anxious child, with an affectively reliable child, or with a child who has psychotic experiences. It's delivered one by one by clinical psychologists who are coaches for this purpose. And it takes about 16 weeks. Once per week, one hour per week for up to 16 weeks. Anything 8 or more weeks we consider is a sufficient dose. And the focus is on building skills. So another busy slide, but what's on the left in red is what we typically would do in cognitive behavioral therapy. Someone comes with a problem, we conceptualize the vicious cycle, what maintains the problem, and we deal with it. We want to break the sample, and that's where the therapy stops. So in skills for wellness, we add the green positive part to it. You know, this example is about unusual experiences. And that's really like not just we solving the problem at hand right now, but also taking it further to create a positive virtuous cycle and to really train the skills that the young person can take forward to deal with new challenges to come. We also believe that it's very important that it's youth focused. It's really, we're working primarily with the young person, even when they are as young as 9, 10 year olds, the young person is our primary client. Then at the end of the session, he or she may bring in their mom or dad and explain them what we're doing, because we need the alliance of the parents to do the in-between work. But they have the primary ownership, and it's really important because they learn skills that will be useful in the future. But by them being the primary customer, they really take ownership for that. They realize that when they manage to do something that looked that they were too scared to even think about before, they know they achieved it themselves. They know it's their work, their achievement. They feel the mastery. They feel, yes, when the next problem comes, I'll be able to deal with it again. And that's just as important as the skills they learn. Well, we still have the acceptability challenge because this may be helpful, but it will only be helpful if people take it up. And essentially, we're offering an intervention to people who have not asked for it. So imagine you get a phone call, you know, we would like to offer your daughter an intervention to reduce the risk of severe mental illness. That would be a kind of scary phone call to get, right? So it's important how we deal with this. There was actually a study that that did exactly this in Netherlands. Children of parents with depression or anxiety recruited specifically for a randomized controlled trial of helpful intervention, including both parents and children in that case. They spent 30 months trying to recruit. They screened 11,000 kids. They found 1,300 of them to be eligible or suitable for the study, and they ended up enrolling 26 of them. Then they closed the shop. That was too few. You know, if you get 1,300 to whom you offer it and you end up with 26, that's too few to really make a representative sample. So they stopped the study because of lack of enrollment. Retrospectively, I'm glad that they only published this in 2014 when we were already on the way with Swell, because had they published it before us, you know, you're supposed to build on previous knowledge and to learn from it. We would not be supposed to try again. And anyway, we did try. We took our own take on the acceptability challenge. So because of that weird design that I showed in the busy slide, right? These families are already in a cohort. They already know us. So it's not as surprising a phone call to get. And the second thing is we try to use very normalizing language, because we're not talking risk and therapy. We say we would like to offer your son a course of sessions to strengthen his mental health skills. Would she be interested? Would he be interested? And we were both curious and kind of anxious, nervous about how that will go. And you know, it so far it's gone very well. So we are in the second year of that study. We, out of 132 participants who are in the age range for that and who have reached that stage in the study, we found 42 of them to be eligible, to be suitable for the study. We randomly allocated them to either be offered the intervention or not. That's what we have to do, because if we don't throw the dice, we will never be able to say whether the intervention actually made a difference. And of the 21 who were allocated to be offered the intervention, 18 not just accepted, but completed the intervention. So that's 86% completion rate. That's as good as any therapy offered to people who were actually asking for it. There was only one single person who said no straight away, I'm not interested. There were two other who stopped early on after a couple of sessions. It, for various reasons, like a new boyfriend. For some reason, all these three who either didn't take it or stopped were either 15 or 16 year olds. I'm starting, you know, the kind of 9 to 12 year olds, it's really golden age. It's wonderful stage. The kids are already intellectually mature enough to benefit. They are receptive. There still are the parents who bring them in, and it works really well. And then the kind of 17, 18 year old, they are more responsible, mature, but the kind of 15, 16 seems to be a difficult age. So I'm rethinking the strategy. Anyway, it's just the first 42 randomized, but so far the experience is good. People are accepting and completing the intervention. They're finding it helpful. We hear a lot of positive feedback of very real life differences it's making. So one of my favorites is credit of the slide to Barbara Pavlova and Alim Awadia, the therapists and supervisors on the intervention part of the study. So one I think 17-year-old girl said, thanks to this, I was able to choose the uni that with the best scholarship. You know, she was anxious. She was going to go to the nearest place when she would know the most people that looked most threatening, even if this wasn't the best opportunity in her life. After the intervention, she was able to make a different choice that's hopefully better for her. The parents are also who comment how much more confident the child is. And the best stories is really when it generalizes, because that's what we really need. When they say, you know, he worked with you on that fear of crossing bridges, for example, but then he went on and changed that and that also, and he's able to go to sleep himself. And that's really key, because, you know, we take the small problem really as an example on which they learn a skill and gain confidence. We're not there to just treat anxiety. We're there to give them skills that will help them to deal with what will come. And so when we hear about the confidence and the skills generalizing to other new challenges, that's what we really hope for. So anyway, we see that it seems to be helpful in the short term. That's also what the symptom data show. That's not really new. We knew that we picked something that is helpful. What we're curious about is whether it will be helpful in the long term, whether we will actually reduce the risk of severe mental illness onset so that we don't see as frequent onsets anymore, since in those where we started this. And that really needs a few more years to go. But it's acceptable, it's working in the short term, so we will give it our best try. We also have further plans. Actually, just a few months ago, one of my colleagues, very close colleague, Barbara Pavlova, got funding for intervention in earlier childhood that will be more focused on the parents. She will pick parents with anxiety who have children with what we call inhibited temperaments. Those are somewhat timid children. And we know that predicts risk of anxiety. So she takes it a step earlier, actually. She will, you know, I'm picking the youth with antecedents and hope to help them with them so that the severe mental illness doesn't develop. She's taking it earlier. She wants to stop the antecedents from developing. And so that will be our next stage, going earlier. We're thinking of the mid-adolescence. One of the major risk factors for psychosis at that stage is marijuana. You know, with the changes we're facing now, marijuana will not become less accessible to youth, right? It will be a bigger problem. The estimates are that right now marijuana is responsible between 15 and 25% of psychotic illness. It's a big factor. Something between 15 and 25%. So up to one quarter of cases of psychosis may be caused by marijuana.
So it's 15 to 25%.
Yes, yeah. And it's really the heavy smoking in teens, in the teen years, that's really dangerous. And there's actually a genetic test that can tell us who is at high risk. Well, I believe we may need to tell the people who are at high risk. So we're also planning a trial that's yet unfunded, but I hope will be funded, to use genetic counseling to actually tell kids who are at high risk for developing psychosis after smoking cannabis that they are. That genetic test does not indicate any higher risk for those who don't smoke cannabis. In other words, it's not a doomed for illness information, right? It's an information, look, cannabis, marijuana is more dangerous for you than for others. And that kind of beats one of the arguments, like so many kids smoke and they're fine, right? So that may be another opportunity to do something. And then more and more I'm feeling, since we've seen so many young people to actually develop depression and other disorders, that we need to do some very early personalized treatment. You know, we've been following them up, we saw them falling ill, so we want to give them the best chance to get the best treatment as early as possible. So these are the future plans. We also do genetic testing and we do brain imaging that started just in the last year, but about 80 of our young people have had a brain scan. They're thoroughly enjoying it. They want to come back very soon. And we hope that the two may be really complementary sources of information. The genetics is generally kind of stable information that will be the same for the life. And so that can help us choose better who needs what kind of intervention. The brain imaging is more like state. It shows us where the brain development is right now and how much the brain is changing and at which stage. And perhaps what changes we can't influence by the interventions. So we hope the brain scanning will help us choose when. And perhaps also whether we've done enough in the intervention. So these are the future plans. So as Forbo is growing, it will be becoming a platform to do more. Anyway, I have to thank many people because Forbo is the work of many. I had a number of very good advisors who helped me shape the projects, a number of co-investigators who are helping it get along. I have a team of about 10 people and many of our alumni are still involved. and several therapists who developed interventions, a couple of psychiatry residents working with us, and two computer guys programming the database behind the scenes so that we can collect data smoothly. So thank you for everyone. This wouldn't be also possible without funding that's come from multiple sources. So Canadian Institutes of Health Research, Canada Researchers Program, Nova Scotia Health Research Foundation, Dalhousie Medical Research Foundation, and most recently, the Royal and the Mach-Gaensslen Foundation. Thank you.